Recorded Books presents Autumn in the Heavenly Kingdom, China, the West, and the Epic Story of the Taiping Civil War by Stephen R. Platt, narrated by Angela Lin and directed by Chris Thies. The author opens with a line from Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. And now, Autumn in the Heavenly Kingdom.
Prologue. Heaven's Children. On an early spring morning in 1853, just northwest of Beijing, the sun rises quietly over the summer palace of Xianfeng, the seventh emperor of the Qing dynasty. The palace sprawls luxuriantly over 800 acres of gardens and ornately constructed buildings, a world within the world of China, from which Xianfeng, like his royal ancestors, rarely needs to go out. There are wooded riding trails, lakes, and opera houses. The grandest landscapes of the empire have been lovingly recreated within the palace compound, in miniature, for the emperor's pleasure. At 21, Xianfeng has been on the throne for only 3 years, but he was born here in this palace, and all he has ever known in his life has been his preparation to become the son of heaven and to rule China. Xianfeng is a Manchu, not Chinese, descended from nomadic outdoorsmen and hunters originally from north of the Great Wall, which the earlier dynasties built to keep out his kind. Barbarians, the Chinese once called them. But his family has ruled China for more than 2 centuries now, since the collapse of the Ming Dynasty under its own weight in 1644. And they govern through a certain indulgence, acting as stewards of Chinese tradition to maintain the loyalty of the Chinese scholars who do the real work of management and bureaucracy. As did the dynasties before them, they hold Confucian examinations to choose officials, recruiting loyal Chinese to administer the empire in their stead. And by now, after so many generations, few question that the Manchus rule by heaven's mandate, and that the Manchu emperor is indeed the divinely chosen ruler of the Chinese. Xianfeng's life is a singularity. As emperor, there is a color of fabric he alone can wear, ink he alone can use, a pronoun whose sole existence in the Chinese language is for him to refer to himself. And such, in a sense, is the condition of the Manchus more widely in the empire. They are a small elite, 3 men to 1,000 Chinese at the time of conquest, with their own language and their own customs, intermarrying among their own people. Like Xianfeng in his palace, his world within a world, most of them live in a handful of cities of their own, the so-called Manchu garrison cities, gated cities within larger gated cities, separated by their own walls from the masses of Chinese outside. There was a time when these Manchus were fierce, and the men would return to their northern homeland in the summer to practice the muscular arts of horsemanship and archery that made them proudly superior to the sedentary Chinese. But things changed as they grew accustomed to their comforts. The emperors are no longer as attentive as they once were. The Manchu men no longer so concerned with physical discipline, with sharpening their martial skills. And so on this spring morning in 1853, in the walled city of Nanjing, a little over 700 miles to the south of Xianfeng's palace, as the rebels, chosen by a different heaven, smash through the outer walls of the city and shout to the civilians to show them the way to the devils, as they push through the inner Manchu city, climbing over one another to scale the wall that encircles the isolated population within. As they do this, the men, who count among the 20,000 or so Manchus living inside the garrison, do not take up their weapons, but instead only throw themselves to the ground and beg for pity. The rebels slaughter them like animals, and then their wives, and all of their daughters and sons. Part 1. Twilight. Chapter 1. The Preacher's Assistant. Hong Kong in 1852 was a diseased and watery place, a rocky island off the southern shore of the Qing Empire, where the inhabitants lived in dread of what one described as the miasma set free from the ground which was everywhere being turned up. A small British settlement sat between the mountains and the bay, but the emerald and sapphire glory of the scene belied the darkness below the surface, leaving the concentration of godowns, military barracks, and trading firms along the colony's nostalgically named central streets, the Queen's Road, Wellington Street, Hollywood Road, one could find the grandest vistas in the gravel paths that led up the coast into the hills. But the European settlement soon gave way to scattered Chinese houses among fields growing rice and sweet potatoes, unchanged in the decades since the British took the island as their prize in the Opium War. Some of the wealthier merchants had built opulent mansions in those hills, with terraced gardens commanding a view of the harbor and town. But as though their builders had strayed too far from the protection of the settlement, the inhabitants of those houses sickened and died, marked as homes of fever or death. The ghostly manors sat silent and abandoned, their empty gaze passing judgment on the settlers below. One of those settlers was Theodore Homberg, a young Swedish missionary with a thin chin-strap beard that set off his delicate, nearly effeminate features. He was blessed with a lovely voice, and in his youth in Stockholm, he had sung together with Jenny Lind, the Swedish nightingale. But while Lind went on to conquer the opera halls of Europe and America, bringing suitors such as Frederick Chopin and Hans Christian Andersen to their knees along the way, Homberg's life took an entirely different path. His strong tenor found its destined outlet in preaching, and in 1847, he left his native Sweden to sail to the opposite end of the world, to this malarial colony of Hong Kong, with the sole purpose of bringing the Chinese to their knees after a different fashion. Theodore Homberg might well have lived his life in obscurity, for his proudest accomplishments meant little to anyone beyond a small circle of Protestant missionaries. He was one of the first Europeans in his generation to brave the Chinese countryside, leaving the relative safety of Hong Kong to preach in a village outside the Chinese trading port of Canton, 100 miles up the Pearl River, though for health reasons he finally returned to the colony. He was also the first to learn to speak the dialect of Hakka, or guest people, a gypsy minority thickly populous in South China. All of that might have meant little to anyone in the world outside, except that one day in the late spring of 1852, one of his converts from the countryside brought a guest to meet him, a short, round-faced Hakka named Hong Rengan, who had a remarkable story to tell. The strangest thing about this Hakka, Homberg recalled from their first meeting, was how much he already seemed to know about God and Jesus, despite the fact that he hailed from well beyond the narrow reach of the Hong Kong missionaries. Homberg listened with curiosity as Hong Rengan gave a baffling account of the events leading to his arrival in Hong Kong. He spoke of visions and battles, armies and congregations of believers, a heavenly prophet from among the Hakkas. He had, or at least so he claimed, been haunted by the agents of the Qing dynasty and had lived in disguise under an assumed name. He had been kidnapped, had escaped, and had lived for 4 days in the forest, 6 days in a cave. None of it made much sense, though, and Homberg confessed, "I could form no clear conception of the whole matter." Not knowing what to make of the story, he asked Hong Rengan to write it down, which he did, and then, Though Homberg had expected him to stay for baptism, he left without explanation. Homberg put the sheets of paper with Hong Rengan's story into his desk and turned his mind to other matters. He would think little of them again for nearly a year, until the spring of 1853, when the news came that Nanjing had fallen in a torrent of blood, and Homberg realized that the strange events sketched out in Hong Rengan's tale meant more than he had ever imagined. News of the mounting upheaval in China reached Homberg and the other settlers in Hong Kong and up the coast in Shanghai, only in scattered and vague accounts. From Chinese government reports, there seemed no pattern to the rising disorder of the early 1850s, no principle or cohesion. Local uprisings and small-scale banditry in China's countryside were a perennial thorn in the side of the imperial authorities, hardly anything new or noteworthy, though they certainly did seem to have increased in the years following the Opium War. Chinese travelers and clandestine Catholic missionaries deep in the interior forwarded rumors of some larger movement led by a man known as Tian De, or Heavenly Virtue. But just as many accounts reported that the man was dead, killed by imperial forces, or that he had never existed in the first place. In the absence of any clear news, the foreigners in their coastal ports paid little attention, concerned only that bandits might disrupt the production of tea and silk. But the fall of the southern capital of Nanjing in 1853 brought a massive civil war right to the doorstep of the foreign settlement in Shanghai, which was just 200 miles downriver, where the Yangtze met the sea. 500,000 rebels, calling themselves the Taiping Tian Guo, Heavenly Kingdom of Great Peace, flooded down from central China on a grand flotilla of commandeered ships to Nanjing, leaving a swath of emptied cities and shattered imperial defenses behind them. And the debate was settled. This was no mere bandit uprising. Fear gripped the city of Shanghai. There was no direct communication with Nanjing, no concrete information. The American steamer, Susquehanna, tried to sail upriver to Nanjing to investigate, but ran aground. Rumors spread that the insurgents would next march on Shanghai to attack the foreigners, and the city's Chinese population boarded up their houses, packed up their furniture, and took to riverboats or fled into the countryside for safety. The foreign settlers called up their unready defenses, rallying up a haphazard volunteer defense corps to man the city walls and bringing up the few ships in ready reach. Two British steamers and a brig of war, and one steamer each for the French and Americans. But there it ended, at least for the time being. The Taiping did not march on Shanghai, and the city's vigilance eased off. Instead, the rebels set their targets northward toward Beijing, the capital of the Manchu rulers, and dug in for a long and bloody campaign, with Nanjing as their base of operations. Their heavenly capital, as Nanjing was now renamed, lay tantalizingly just out of reach of Shanghai. One British ship did manage to visit in late April 1853, but brought back conflicting impressions of what was happening there, the clearest opinion being that of the British plenipotentiary, who declared the Taiping to have an ideology of superstition and nonsense. The visitors learned nothing about the rebels' origins. Despite the scarcity of clear information, raw accounts of the civil war in China radiated outward from Shanghai and Hong Kong to capture the imagination of the Western world. Europe had been through its own upheavals just 5 years earlier with the revolutions of 1848, and the events in China seemed a remarkable parallel. The downtrodden people of China, oppressed by their Manchu overlords, had, it seemed, risen up to demand satisfaction. The Economist called it a social change or convulsion such as have of late afflicted Europe, and mused that it is singular to find similar commotions at the same time in Asia and Europe. Here was evidence that the empire at the other end of the world was now connected to the economic and political systems of the West. Karl Marx, in 1853, a London correspondent for the New York Daily Tribune, struggling to give shape to his ideas on capitalism, likewise considered the rebellion in China to be a sign of China's integration into the global economy, describing it as the end result of Britain's forcing China open to foreign trade in the recent Opium War. In Marxist terminology, what was happening in China was not merely a rebellion or a hodgepodge of uprisings, but one formidable revolution, one that demonstrated the interconnectedness of the industrial world. Indeed, it was in China, he argued, that one could see the future of the West. The next uprising of the people of Europe and their next movement for republican freedom and economy of government, he wrote, may depend more probably on what is now passing in the Celestial Empire, the very opposite of Europe, than on any other political cause that now exists. As he explained it, the disorder in China had its roots in the opium trade. A decade earlier, Britain had cracked China's markets open with its warships, and in doing so, it had undermined the superstitious faith of the Chinese in their ruling dynasty. Exposure to the world meant the destruction of the old order, he believed, for dissolution must follow as surely as that of any mummy carefully preserved in a hermetically sealed coffin whenever it is brought into contact with the open air. But the effects of the Qing dynasty's dissolution would not be limited to China itself. The whole of the Taiping Revolution was, in his mind, Britain's fault. And now, the effects of her actions overseas were going to be felt back home. The question, he wrote, is how that revolution will in time react on England, and through England, on Europe. Marx predicted that the loss of China's markets to the Taiping Revolution would undermine British exports of cotton and wool. Merchants in a chaotic China would accept only bullion in exchange for their goods, sapping Britain's stores of precious metals. Worse, the revolution would cut off England's source of tea imports, and the price of tea, to which most of the British were addicted, would spike in England at the same time that a poor harvest in Western Europe looked likely to send food prices through the roof, reducing still further the demand for manufactured goods and undermining the whole manufacturing industry on which Britain's economy depended. It may be safely augured, Marx concluded, that the Chinese Revolution will throw the spark into the overloaded mine of the present industrial system and cause the explosion of the long-prepared general crisis, which, spreading abroad, will be closely followed by political revolutions on the continent. If Marx was keen to convince the readers of the New York Daily Tribune that the Chinese Civil War was one of class struggle and economic revolution analogous to the movements in Europe, the editors of the Daily Picayune in the southern slave port of New Orleans saw it in rather different terms, after their own particular vision of the world. It was, as they saw it, a racial war, and China was a slave state in upheaval. The Taiping had emerged, the editors explained, from the southern provinces of Guangxi and Guangdong, whose inhabitants were principally of the primitive Chinese race. The northern Manchus, in contrast, were the ruling race in China, who had taken the throne 200 years earlier, since which time China has been accordingly ruled as a conquered country by its masters. The two races never mixed, they explained, and in accordance with their southern vision of a harmonious slave-based society, the Picayune offered that in China, the quiet, patient, laboring millions have submitted to their masters mostly with exemplary gentleness. The sole threat to the stability of this Manchu Chinese country of peacefully coexisting masters and slaves was these primitive people of South China who refused to submit to the yoke. The Taiping Rebellion, then, was a dark analogy to an uprising of African slaves in the United States. The London Times, for its part, was the most prescient of observers, honing in immediately on the question of whether Britain should send its navy into the Chinese conflict, and, if so, on which side. In an editorial on May 17, 1853, just after the news of Nanjing's fall reached London, the Times noted that the Taiping seemed unstoppable and that, according to all computable chances, they will succeed thus far in subverting the government of China. The Times also ran a report from a Shanghai paper asking whether a change of masters was something desired by the Chinese nation at large, offering that the Taiping, though hardly beloved in northern China, represented a force of change that was indeed welcome to the Chinese. And throughout the country, the feeling seems to be growing deeper that the exactions and oppressions of the Mandarins are no longer to be borne. By the end of the summer, the Times declared flatly that the rebellion in China was, in all respects, the greatest revolution the world has yet seen. But the rebels themselves were a cipher. The reader of the Times would easily conclude that the Taiping enjoyed the support, grudging at least, of the Chinese people, and were poised to overthrow the Manchus and usher in a new era of government. But the editors also sounded a note of caution about Britain's ignorance. "We are without any substantial information as to the origin or objects of the rebellion," they wrote. "We know that the existing government of China is likely to be subverted in a civil war, but nothing more." Britain, they worried, simply didn't know enough about the nature or ideology of the rebels to decide whether it should support or encourage them. "We cannot tell in the case before us on which side our interest or our duties may lie, whether the insurrection is justifiable or unjustifiable, promising or unpromising, whether the feelings of the people are involved in it or not, or whether its success would bring a change for the better or worse, or any change at all in our relations with the Chinese." As it turned out, however, answers to the most pressing of these questions, of the origins of the rebellion, of who the Taiping really were and what they believed in, were to be found in Hong Kong, scribbled on a few stray sheets of paper stuffed into a drawer in Theodore Homberg's desk. The following autumn, Hong Rengan sought out Homberg again, now in his village station outside Canton. And this time, the missionary knew him for who he was, the cousin and lifelong companion of the Heavenly King of the Taiping, severed from the movement and blown to Hong Kong by the vagaries of chance. He was the only person in contact with a foreigner who had first-hand knowledge of the forces that had risen up in the interior of China, forces that now, as the world finally took notice and watched from afar, threatened to destroy the ruling dynasty from within. Homberg and Hong Rengan formed a close friendship. The 34-year-old missionary and the 31-year-old refugee. And Homberg finally got to baptize his friend in September 1853, before taking him back to Hong Kong. Homberg instructed Hong Rengan carefully in Lutheran doctrine, preparing him to serve as an assistant to the foreign preachers and eventually to take their brand of Christianity to the Taiping in Nanjing, though Hong Rengan later claimed that it was he who had spent those months teaching the foreigners, not the other way around. As they worked together, Homberg, with his halting command of Hakka dialect, managed to tease out the details hinted at in Hong Rengan's written account, and to pull together the full story of who this man was and where he had come from. As Hong Rengan told the story, it was his cousin, Hong Xiu Quan, 9 years older, who had always been the brilliant one. They lived in neighboring villages about 30 miles from the provincial capital of Canton, close enough to see the White Cloud Mountains northeast of the city on a clear day. The villagers were mostly relatives from their clan, which had once been a grand one. Back in the days of the Song Dynasty, many of them had served as high officials and imperial advisors, but that was a very long time ago, and now they were poor farmers. They did, however, have a small schoolhouse where Hong Xiu Quan began studying the Confucian classics at the age of 7. He distinguished himself immediately, and in a few years had memorized the 4 books, the 5 classics, and the other texts required for the civil service examinations. By his early teens, he had also read widely in Chinese history and literature, and was so bright, his family believed, that he could understand the ancient texts at first reading without assistance. They dreamed that he would restore their long-lost family glory, and several of his teachers worked without pay in hopes that their reward would come when he passed the exams and became an official. As his need for more specialized training took him to schools farther from the village, his family pooled their resources to support him, though by age 16 he was already supporting himself as a schoolteacher, with a small salary paid primarily in rice, lard, salt, and lamp oil. Passing the Confucian civil service examinations was the key to gaining an official appointment in the Qing Dynasty government, and that was the goal to which both cousins aspired. But the examinations were fabulously difficult, and failure at the provincial level usually meant years of waiting for the next chance to compete. The actual process of taking the provincial exam consisted of 3 days in a dank, musty cubicle in Canton, proving one's mastery of the Confucian classics. And though Hong Rengan himself never had much success, when Hong Xiu Quan traveled to Canton to compete for the first time in 1827, he placed high in the rankings on the first day. As the examination wore on through its full span, however, his name slipped in the rankings, and by the end of the 3rd and final day, he had fallen out of the circle of winners. It was 9 more years before he finally qualified to take the exam again, in 1836, and on that occasion, he failed for a second time. Hong Rengan also never managed to pass, but it was Hong Xiu Quan who had their entire extended family's hopes riding on him. So that may be why he was the one who finally suffered a breakdown. Hong Xiu Quan had his first visions in 1837, just after failing the examination for a 3rd time. Weakened by the ordeal, he had to be carried home afterward. When he got there, he collapsed into bed and called his family, who crowded around him. He apologized to them that his life was over and he had let them down. Then he closed his eyes and lost all strength. They thought he was dead, but eventually he woke up and began telling them about strange things he had seen while he was asleep. In his dream, a dragon, a tiger, and a cock had entered the room, followed by musicians with a sedan chair. They carried him away to a beautiful and luminous place, full of men and women who rejoiced when they saw him, and an old woman who washed him to remove the defilements from his body. A group of old men also appeared, and he recognized some of them as the sages of ancient China. They slit open his body with a knife, removed his organs, and replaced them with new ones, red in color. Then they closed him up, though later he could never find any trace of the incision. He was escorted into a grand hall, where in the highest position sat an old man in a black robe with a flowing beard of gold. The old man wept that the people of the world did not venerate him. "They take of my gifts," he told Hong Xiuquan, and therewith worship demons. They purposely rebel against me and arouse my anger. Do not thou imitate them. He then gave Hong Xiuquan a sword for killing demons, but admonished him not to use it on his brothers and sisters, as well as a seal and a piece of yellow fruit, which he ate. It was sweet. The old man in black led him to look down at the people on the earth, where everywhere he could see defilement and perversion. Then he woke up. Hong Xiuquan's visions continued off and on for 40 days, and Hong Rengan stayed by his cousin's side, listening in his waking moments to hear stories of what he had seen. There were other recurrent characters. One, a middle-aged man he called Elder Brother, who traveled with him to the uttermost regions of the world to slay demons with his sword. In another dream vision, the old man in black was berating Confucius for failing to teach proper doctrine to the Chinese people, and Confucius humbly confessed his guilt and shame while Hong Xiuquan looked on. His brothers kept the doors to the house locked during those weeks, and they would sometimes catch Hong Xiuquan leaping about his room, shouting, "Kill the demons!" and slashing wildly at the air. His insanity drew the curiosity and amusement of neighbors, who came to look at him as he slept, to see the famous madman close up. At one point, he woke up claiming to be the Emperor of China. His family was shamed and worried. As Hong Rengan explained to Theodore Homberg, his friends and relatives only replied that the whole was strange indeed, without thinking at the time that there was any reality in the matter. What Hong Rengan didn't believe at the time, but did believe by the time he recounted his story to Homberg, was that his cousin's visions were, in fact, divine revelations. Hong Xiuquan finally recovered, and Hong Rengan saw that he was literally a different person after his ordeal, taller, stronger, and vastly more intelligent. He was now more handsome, with fair skin and high nose. His gaze had become piercing and difficult to endure. His voice boomed, and when he laughed, the whole house resounded. Healthier and sharper of mind than ever before, he returned to his teaching and his preparation for the civil service exams. But he was no more successful than before. In 1843, he sat for the examination in Canton for the fourth time, and failed yet again. That was the year another cousin found a forgotten book in Hong's cabinet. It was a Christian tract in Chinese, which a missionary had pressed into his hands some years before in Canton, but which he had never read. The cousin looked it over and thought it interesting, so Hong Xiuquan took the time to read it carefully, and thus came his epiphany. That book, he told Hong Rengan, unlocked the secret of his dream visions from 6 years before. After reading the basic tenets of Christianity, he suddenly understood it all. The old man in black with the golden beard who had commanded him was God, and the elder brother who had helped him slay demons was Jesus Christ. The demons were the idols worshipped by the Chinese in their Confucian and Buddhist temples, and his brothers and sisters were the Chinese people. Hong Xiuquan baptized himself, then threw away the Confucian tablets in his schoolroom. Hong Rengan was Hong Xiuquan's first convert, along with a neighbor named Feng Yunshan. They baptized themselves in a river and took down the idols in their classrooms, the tablets and likenesses of Confucius that were icons of the state religion of Confucianism, which lay at the heart of the examination system. The three began studying together, gathering translated Christian texts where they could find them. Hong Xiuquan preached to them, and soon to others, drawn in by his message, using the gospel tracts and his visions as complements, each, he claimed, proving the truth of the other. The Bible, he believed, had been written explicitly for himself. The three believers, Hong Xiuquan, Hong Rengan, and Feng Yunshan, now began to convert their parents, their brothers and sisters, their wives and their children to the god for whom Hong Xiu Chen was prophet. It didn't always go easily. Hong Rengan's older brother beat him with a stick for taking down the Confucian tablets, which caused his students to abandon the school and left him with no income. Hong Rengan, indignant, replied, "Am I not the teacher? How is Confucius able to teach after being dead so long? Why do you force me to worship him?" Hong Xiu Chen and Feng Yunshan left in 1844 to spread their word to other villages and far-flung family members throughout the province. And though Hong Rengan desperately wanted to join them, his relatives forced him to stay as a school teacher because he was only 22 years old. He had to put the Confucian tablets back up to get his students to return. But even staying put, he managed to baptize at least 50 or 60 converts, which was a good deal more than Homberg would ever manage in his own career. As Feng Yunshan preached from village to village in the mountainous regions of the neighboring province of Guangxi, the movement grew and spread. Autonomous congregations sprang up, numbering in the hundreds of followers who refer to themselves as part of a society of God-worshippers. They took Hong Xiu Chen, whom many had never met, as their spiritual leader. When Hong Xiu Chen came back home in 1845, Hong Rengan noted a shift in his ideology. He was no longer solely concerned with Confucianism, with replacing it with the worship of God. There was a new tone to his preaching that disparaged the ethnically Manchu rulers of the Qing dynasty as the wrongful usurpers of China. "God has divided the kingdoms of the world and made the ocean to be a boundary for them, just as a father divides his estates among his sons," Hong Xiu Chen explained to his cousin. "Why should these Manchus forcibly enter China and rob their brothers of their estate?" His religious movement was becoming a political one. By 1847, there were about 2,000 followers of the society, primarily from the Hakka population. Emboldened by their faith and their numbers, they began smashing Buddhist idols and temples, raising the suspicions of the authorities. By 1849, the independent congregations were having fits, speaking in tongues. They looked to Hong Xiu Chen to tell them which of their channeled words came from God and which came from the devil. A pestilence ravaged the province in 1850, and when word spread that sick people could be healed by praying to Hong Xiu Chen's God, the numbers exploded. Multitudes joined the society, and after the disease had passed, they gave credit for their survival to Hong Xiu Chen's religion. But none of that was enough to call an army into being. What tipped the scales was an outburst of violence between Hakka and native settlers in Guangxi province. The Hakkas, as latecomers, had to scrabble for land and water rights, and the more long-standing local families scorned them as interlopers. A small-scale war broke out between a handful of Hakka and native villages in the autumn of 1850. The natives burned down the homes of the Hakkas, and the Hakkas turned to the Society of God Worshippers for protection and support. Local authorities, already suspicious of the religious sect, now began to view it as a harbor for troublemakers. But according to Hong Rengan, Hong Xiu Chen had foreseen all this and waited patiently to make his move. As the Hakka native violence spread, Qing officials, who blamed the trouble on the Hakkas, sent a body of soldiers to round up Hong Xiu Chen and Feng Yunshan. Getting wind of the plan, a nearby congregation of God-worshippers armed themselves with swords and spears and marched overland to save their leader. They easily routed the outnumbered imperial soldiers, and Hong Xiu Chen sent out word calling for all of the God-worshippers from across the districts to gather in one place for the first time and prepare for the next stage of their movement. Many had already sold their houses and land in preparation. Over the following days, they assembled and found that they now numbered in tens of thousands. With little effort, they took possession of a small town, their first military victory. Imperial soldiers laid siege, firing on the god worshippers from outside. But they managed to slip out in the middle of the night, and in the morning, the Imperials fell on a nearly empty town. Troops dispatched to pursue them were cut down in the woods, and the Imperial soldiers wreaked their frustrated revenge on the unfortunate townspeople who had stayed behind. On January 11, 1851, Hong Xiuquan declared the founding of the Taiping Heavenly Kingdom, with himself as the new emperor, or Heavenly King of China. Feng Yunshan and three other lieutenants were appointed kings of the four directions. Through 1851 and 1852, the Taiping army fought its way north, absorbing the poor and disenfranchised, the criminals, all those who feared or hated the reigning Qing Dynasty authorities, all who would convert to their brand of Christianity and commit themselves to the destruction of Confucianism and, above all, the Manchu overlords. By the time they reached the Yangtze River, cutting through central China in January 1853, there were 500,000 of them, though Feng Yunshan and untold numbers of others had died along the way. But Hong Rengan knew of this only through hearsay. He had been too late to the first assembly point and arrived at the town after the god worshippers had already slipped out in the night. Trying to follow them, he had found only imperial patrols hunting for stragglers, and thus had begun his flight and his disguises, pursued by Qing agents who burned his home village to the ground, his kidnapping at the hands of a man who wanted the bounty on his head, his escape, and finally his asylum in Hong Kong with the Swedish missionary Homberg. The one thing Theodore Homberg would do in his life to capture the attention of the world beyond his small circle of missionaries was to translate Hong Rengan's account into English and publish it. He did so because it had convinced him of what was, to him, the most marvelous, the most improbable, and amazing fact of the rebellion, namely that the rebels who had risen up from the heart of China to overthrow the Manchus were Christians. His book came out first in Hong Kong and Shanghai as The Visions of Hong Xiuquan, then in London as The Chinese Rebel Chief. It was nothing less than propaganda, seeking to convince the readers of the English-speaking world that the Taiping rebels worshipped the same god they did. It was, furthermore, an attempt to draw foreign support toward the rebels by awakening, in Homberg's words, a more lively and permanent sympathy on behalf of the millions of China. By which he did not, of course, mean the people of China, who remained loyal to the Manchus. Finally, Homberg published the book to raise money for the cause, of which he had, through his friendship with Hong Rengan, become a clear partisan. "It may add to the satisfaction of the readers," he wrote at the end of the volume, "to know that while they are promoting the sale of the book, they are also relieving the distress of many who form the subjects of its pages." In May 1854, as he finished work on the book, Homberg gave Hong Rengan and two friends money to travel to Shanghai in the hope that they could make their way up the Yangtze River, across the Qing cordons, to rejoin the Taiping movement in Nanjing. He loaded Hong Rengan down with gifts. There was a range of Chinese books, authorized Bible translations compiled by the foreign missionaries, along with translated works of history and several maps showing the world, China, and the Holy Land. Homberg also gave him the standard tokens of the European trying to impress a Chinese audience: a telescope, a thermometer, a compass, though the Chinese had invented that one. He hoped that Hong Rengan would be the European missionary's conduit to the Taiping, And that would just be the start. Homberg's real hope was that once they got to Nanjing, he himself could follow them and join the movement as a religious teacher. Hong Rengan had mentioned on occasion how much he would like to have Homberg with him in the heavenly capital. But Homberg didn't want to be presumptuous and insisted that he wouldn't try to join the Taiping unless they gave him a formal invitation. The journey, however, was a failure. Hong Rengan had a falling out with his missionary hosts in Shanghai. They found an opium pipe in his room, though he claimed that a visiting friend had left it there. And at any rate, they didn't have the means to help him get to Nanjing. The Chinese portion of the city was in rebellion, controlled by a secret society sympathetic to the Taiping that didn't believe he was related to the Heavenly King and refused to help him. Hong spent a few months in Shanghai, casting about and studying astronomy and mathematics at a missionary school before giving up on rejoining the Taiping. He took a steamer back to Hong Kong, sailing through the waters off the Chinese coast at a breathtaking speed, and wrote a poem comparing the choppy sea to a battleground, the sound of the ship cutting through the waves to a host of 10,000 men in battle, suggesting a longing for the war in which he couldn't take part. His Swedish friend wasn't there to greet him when he got back to Hong Kong, however. A few days after Hong Rengan's departure for Shanghai, the miasma of the colony caught up with Theodore Homberg, and he died of dysentery at the age of 35. Hong Rengan's return to Hong Kong in 1855 promised to be a permanent one, and he found long-term employment as a catechist and assistant to the preachers of the London Missionary Society. He was well-trusted, a baptized Christian known for his friendship with the late Theodore Homberg, and his amiable personality won him the favor of the broader missionary community. His supervisor and closest collaborator for the following years was the stodgy, mutton-chopped Scottish missionary, James Legge, who was embarking on a project to make English translations of the whole of the Confucian canon, the same texts on which the infernal civil service exams were based. Legge and Hong worked closely together and often preached in tandem. First Legge in his newly acquired Cantonese, then Hong Rengan in Hakka dialect. In contrast to his past practice, Hong Rengan's sermons in Hong Kong reflected James Legge's doctrine, not his cousin's. Legge, who did not lightly praise anyone who was Chinese, held an unbounded affection for Hong Rengan and described him as the most genial and versatile Chinese I have ever known. Legge's daughter seconded this, testifying that her curmudgeonly father felt for Hong Rengan a special affection and a warmth of admiration such as he gave to hardly any other Chinaman. Indeed, there was something in Hong Rengan's personality, a quality of humility, of intelligence, that caught the attention of many of the missionaries he worked with. Another described him as a man of exceptional ability and fine character, who possessed a clear and intelligent acquaintance with Christian truth. One of Legge's counterparts in the London Missionary Society quipped that whenever you saw a Chinese person having frequent conversations with Hong Rengan, you may be sure that there is something good going on in him. And it wasn't just the foreigners who admired him. A Chinese doctor, educated in Edinburgh, likewise described him as a man of great intelligence and considerable fluency of speech. In light of later events, however, others would look back years later and wonder whether it had all been a ruse, whether Hong Rengan's amiable disposition and Christian sweetness that so endeared him to the foreigners had been nothing more than the clothing of a sheep hiding a wolf within. The population of Hong Kong began to shift in those years after the fall of Nanjing. The Manchu government set into motion a broad campaign to hunt down and execute all of the followers of the Taiping they could capture, sending refugees fleeing to the safety and stability of the British colony. T. Qing officers couldn't touch the Taiping-controlled regions around Nanjing. But in other parts of China, still nominally under the control of the central government, the purge of sympathizers was merciless. The government's targets included not just the partisans themselves, but also the relatives, however innocent, of every known member of the Taiping movement, out to the furthest branches of their family tree. The Qing Governor General in Canton, just 100 miles up the Pearl River from Hong Kong, led an especially brutal regional effort to crush the sympathizers. In response to a secret society uprising that he determined, most likely erroneously, was in support of the insurgents in Nanjing, his agents cast a dragnet across the province in 1854 that ensnared an estimated 75,000 accused Taiping supporters. And for those who weren't immediately captured, the government set up suicide stations, pavilions with tools for killing oneself, daggers, ropes, emblazoned with placards calling for supporters of the insurrection to choose a quick self-imposed death over the eventual capture and dismemberment that would bring greater shame to their families. Through 1854 and into 1855, the Governor General in Canton oversaw what the British Council described as a series of executions among the most horrible for extent and manner of which the world has any authentic records. According to one British eyewitness, tens of thousands of accused Taiping supporters were slaughtered in the Canton execution ground, a narrow alleyway crammed with pottery, it being a marketplace in less troubled times, that stank with congealed blood. Thousands were put to the sword, hundreds cast into the river, tied together in batches of a dozen, he testified. And he watched in horror as the accused were butchered, one executioner to grip the topknot of the bound, kneeling prisoner, and another to chop off his head with the sword. Despite the cramped quarters, the teams worked with revolting efficiency, and this witness counted 63 men decapitated in the space of 4 minutes before he had to stop watching. "I have seen the horrid sight," he wrote, "and the limbless, headless corpse, merely a mass of flayed flesh among headless trunks, that lay in scores covering the whole execution ground. There were chests for sending the severed heads of the prisoners up to the Governor General as proof of effective punishment. But so many were executed that their heads wouldn't fit, and the executioners eventually packed only the ears, the right ears specifically, which alone filled the boxes to overflowing." Another witness to the violence was a Chinese man named Yang Wing, who had just returned from the United States after graduating from Yale University in 1854. Thoroughly Americanized, he hoped to work for the Qing government and promote education reform on an American model. He traveled first to Canton to refresh his nearly forgotten Chinese, but found a scene in the execution grounds that made him rethink his support for a government that could condone such barbaric acts. As he described it, "But oh, what a sight! The ground was perfectly drenched with human blood. On both sides of the driveway were to be seen headless human trunks piled up in heaps, waiting to be taken away for burial. So many were killed that no provision had been made to find a place large enough to bury all the bodies. There they were left exposed to a burning sun. The temperature stood from morning to night in midsummer steadily at 90 Fahrenheit and sometimes higher. The atmosphere within a radius of 2,000 yards of the execution ground was heavily charged with a poisonous and pestilential vapor that was reeking from the ground already oversaturated with blood and from the heaps of corpses, which had been left behind for at least 2 days. The executions in Canton were a major turning point in the fortunes of Hong Kong. Refugees flooded into the colony, not just the fugitives threatened by the Governor General's men, but also wealthy merchants from South China seeking a more stable base from which to run their businesses. Hong Kong boomed as the new arrivals built houses, drove up the rents on existing structures, founded new trading companies, and generally infused a vibrant new life into the city. The missionaries rejoiced. It may have been difficult for foreign preachers to travel to Canton, but in time, it seemed, all of Canton might eventually come to them. The brutal and bloody crackdown in Canton also cast the Qing government in a cold new light, and even those outside who questioned the motives of the Taiping couldn't defend the barbarism and horror of the existing regime's reaction to it. Leg knew well that his 33-year-old assistant, Hong Rengan, was the cousin of the Taiping Heavenly King, but he wasn't nearly as enamored of the rebels as Homberg had been. He maintained that the Taiping weren't true Christians, insofar as their doctrines stemmed from their so-called Heavenly King rather than any accepted denomination. There was also the thorny issue of Hong Xiu Chen's believing himself to be the younger brother of Jesus Christ. For all his affection for Hong Rengan, Leg was largely unconcerned about the doings of Hong's extended family and advised him constantly to put thoughts of Nanjing behind him, to devote his life instead to preaching and studying in Hong Kong. For if events of the wider sphere continued as they were going, he believed surely all of China would be thrown open to the missionaries in time. Hong Rengan, for his part, seemed to take Leg's advice to heart, and the years marched past. He took on a range of duties, visiting prisoners in the jail and preaching in the hospital, as well as traveling with Leg. There was an Anglo-Chinese college founded by missionaries where Hong Rengan taught Chinese history and literature to Chinese Christian students, and he also helped Leg with his Confucian translations, leading Leg through the interpretations of the classics he had mastered for his now-abandoned dream of becoming a civil servant in the Qing Empire. As the civil war in North China ground to a stalemate and the south of the country convulsed with reprisals, Hong Rengan worked safely, quietly, and efficiently as Leg's assistant in Hong Kong, far out of reach both of his brethren in the Taiping and of the Qing authorities, who would execute him on the spot if they could catch him. Even more significantly for later events, Hong Rengan also gained an enormous amount of knowledge about life outside China during those years in Hong Kong. Not perhaps as much as Yang Wing with his Yale education and years of residence in the United States, but certainly worlds more than any other supporter of the Taiping movement. Though still technically in China, Hong Kong was a node linked to the wider world of the British Empire. In the schools run by the missionaries and in the books they translated to promote the strengths and discoveries of their own civilization, he learned about European and American ideas of political economy, science, medicine, government administration, and even military science. He saw the workings of the British colony, the ways in which life was ordered, the place of trade in its economy, the place of the church in its moral life. These were glimpses of a society far removed from the one he had known, and they left impressions he would long carry with him. Above all, though, it was an idyllic life in those years, and he and Leg interspersed their studies and preaching with hikes in the hills above the city. Through 4 years of warfare on the mainland, they enjoyed a life dominated by books, sermons, and picnics. But Hong Rengan's popularity cut both ways, for he was popular, indeed enormously popular, not just with the missionaries, but also with the crowds of Chinese that gathered around him whenever he ventured out, the crowds of refugees driven to Hong Kong by the specter of the execution grounds in Canton. James Leg knew full well that those who pressed against Hong Rengan as he stepped off at the dock weren't asking him about religion, at least not in Leg's sense. They were asking about his cousin and the rebellion, and whether he would lead them to Nanjing and the Heavenly Kingdom. Other missionaries whispered that if Hong Rengan could just get to Nanjing, he could be the one to correct their doctrines after everything he had learned in Hong Kong. He could single-handedly be the man to bring true Christianity to China at last. And it was those missionaries who, behind Leg's back, had their way in the end. Hong Rengan disappeared while Leg was away for home leave in the late spring of 1858. Other missionaries gave him money for the trip, and promised a stipend for the family members he left behind. But with regard to Leg, who steadfastly told him to stay away from the Taiping, it was a secret. He left one record of his state of mind when he gave up the safety of Hong Kong. It was an optimistic poem of departure, the voice of a solitary traveler finally awakened, preparing to rejoin his family and his congregation. The southern flight of wild geese awakens me from my bed, and I arise to confront the wind-blown sails and the shiny banks of the river. There are no musicians to honor my departure, so I'll write my own lines to fly on a banner from the mast. My thoughts are as deep as the spring grass, waving green. Though mountains divide them, the geese throng with excitement. Roll up your sleeves and steer your boat. Pay no mind to me. From this point onward, the hero's powers will know no boundary. This time, he didn't take a load of Bibles or a telescope, nor did he have the convenience of a steamship. He didn't take the crowds who had thronged him in Hong Kong, or even the few family members who had managed to join him there. He left his older brother behind as head servant in Leg's household, where he would be safe. Then he set off alone, in disguise, to attempt the journey overland across 700 miles of war-torn Chinese countryside to Nanjing. Chapter 2. Neutrality. In early May 1858, 1,800 miles up the coast from where Hong Rengan was preparing for his departure, the 1,287-ton paddle steamer HMS Furious bobbed and creaked in the cold, muddy waters 9 miles off China's northeastern shore. Pacing the deck was James Bruce, the 8th Earl of Elgin, stout of body, ruddy of complexion, and disarmingly gentle of demeanor. The Furious was his flagship, the linchpin in a fleet of 21 ships assembled by the governments of Britain and France that sat ominously waiting for orders from its joint commanders. They would have been within sight of shore if it hadn't been for the weather. A thick fog that boiled in spite of the howling winds, made painful by sand-like grit blowing down from the plains of Manchuria. Roughly once a week, it cleared enough for the sailors to spot the defenses along the flat strip of shore, marking the entrance of the waterway that led, eventually, to the imperial capital, Beijing. This was the mouth of the Baihe, the White River, which spread wide over 6 miles of shoreline in a bar only a couple of feet deep at low tide, and the defenses were the forts at Taku, 5 of them arranged along the 2 banks of the river's mouth. The Taku forts were the maritime gateway to the capital and the single most strategically important naval fortification on the entire Chinese coast. The French-British alliance was a new and tentative one, dating from the recently ended Crimean War, and France had sent Baron Gros to join Lord Elgin as joint commander of the expedition. A diplomatic party from the United States tagged along in a neutral capacity, as did the old enemy from the Crimea, Russia. The Americans sailed on the Mississippi, and the Russians, confusingly enough, on the America. To make the point that this was indeed a joint expedition, the French flagship Audacieuse served as the meeting space for the 4 countries' agents as they waited for the weather to clear. Lord Elgin knew that his home government wanted him to take pains to show that Britain wasn't after a monopoly on the China trade, so it was vital that the French participate in this expedition as belligerents. For the same reason, he wished the Americans and Russians would abandon their neutral stance as well. The so-called treaty ports in Shanghai and down the coast were open to all, even though it was British guns that had opened them in the Opium War. Hong Kong alone was a true British colony, and that was a source of some small embarrassment. In any case, if this fleet should succeed in its mission, He knew that the neutral Americans and Russians would gain every concession and trading right the British and French sailors planned to risk their lives for, but without lifting a finger. That was a minor annoyance, though it at least helped support Britain's pretense that her goals in China were unselfish. As long as at least the French also manned their guns, Elgin could honorably claim that any fight with China's imperial government that might ensue was for the higher principles of trade and international relations, not for the expansion of the British Empire. The fleet's presence had nothing to do with the war between the Qing Dynasty and the Taiping, at least not that its commanders intended. Foreign governments had uniformly avoided taking sides in the Chinese Civil War, preferring a principled stand of neutrality that cloaked a more calculating desire to wait and see which side would emerge victorious. Not that the same could be said for their individual citizens, a number of whom found gainful, if short-lived, careers as mercenaries for the imperial government, which paid skippers' wages in comparison to the paltry salaries of their own country's services. In 1855, the British governor of Hong Kong tried to stop the flow of opportunists from Hong Kong and Shanghai into the war zones by issuing a formal order that all British subjects in China must maintain strict neutrality between the different parties at present contending for dominion in that empire, and promising prison time or a hefty fine for any crown subjects who violated neutrality. The order, which carried the force of law, managed well enough to restrict intervention from the regular military, but it hardly mattered to the deserters from ships and unlucky gold diggers from California, who formed the bulk of the mercenaries and who avoided the governor's orders by simply renouncing their British citizenship and becoming Americans. Englishmen, as such, noted one observer to the process, disappeared from the stage altogether. Neutrality, however, could take many forms, and several foreigners with diplomatic clout, especially missionaries who cited Homberg's evidence that the rebels were Christian, had gone so far as to advocate recognition of the Taiping as an independent government. Peter Parker, an American missionary who served as the U.S. commissioner in 1856, sent back dispatches to Washington, claiming that public opinion in the Qing Empire had shifted decisively in favor of the rebels, while another American missionary, William Alexander Parsons Martin, published an open letter to the U.S. government in 1857, declaring that the Taiping regime had achieved its own independence, and that there now were, de facto, two Chinas. The new Christian Chinese state, based in Nanjing, would rule the rich tea and silk-producing regions of the Yangtze Valley and to the south, he predicted, while the older China of the Manchus would continue to govern the extreme north from Beijing. He believed that the Manchu government was too far gone in senility to afford any encouraging prospects of reformation, and therefore suggested that the foreign powers consider the expediency of recognizing its youthful rival, which, catching the spirit of the age, may be prevailed upon to unlock the treasures of the interior and throw open its portals to unrestricted intercourse. The latter missionary now served as secretary and interpreter to the U.S. representative in Elgin's fleet. Regardless of whether it formally recognized the Taiping, Britain's neutrality in the Civil War did not inhibit it from picking its own separate fight with the Manchus at precisely the same time. Indeed, the fact that the Taiping had already brought the dynasty to its knees made for quite a nice window of opportunity. The rebels were draining off the dynasty's best resources and disrupting traffic on the Grand Canal, the centuries-old inland waterway that carried grain from the south to supply Beijing. Without grain shipments, Beijing would starve, and the capital's residents lived a precarious and fearful existence. Into this fragile state of affairs entered Britain with a new war on China, if it really deserved to be called a war, a haphazard and undirected one, entirely one-sided, that had grown from its increasingly forceful attempts to revise the 1842 treaty from the Opium War to give British merchants even greater access to Chinese markets. On the slimmest of pretexts, the 1856 arrest by Qing authorities in Canton of a Chinese smuggling ship named the Arrow, which happened to fly the British flag and whose boarding was thus taken as an insult to the British crown, the Hong Kong governor demanded action. And back in London, Lord Palmerston, the Prime Minister, dispatched Elgin on a mission to China in 1857, charging him to gain reparations and a new treaty at almost any cost. That meant negotiating with the emperor himself, or at least a commissioner stationed close enough to Beijing to speak on his behalf, which meant Elgin had to take his forces right to the emperor's doorstep at the Bai He. There had been several delays along the way. Elgin left England with a respectable force of 1,700 troops in 1857, but as they passed through Ceylon on their way to China, the sepoy mutiny broke out in India. The desperate British governor in Calcutta begged Elgin to loan him the men, which he did. Elgin's troops proved indispensable during the bloody siege of Delhi that summer, and some said they turned the tide of the mutiny in Britain's favor. But it derailed his own mission, and he had to stay for a time in India as a guest in the Governor-General's opulent Calcutta mansion. There, in the very quintessence of colonial decadence, Elgin began to confront a certain discomfort that had been growing inside him since he had left on his mission, namely, that he found the conduct of his countrymen in Asia morally repulsive. As he wrote in Calcutta, "It is a terrible business, this living among inferior races." Terrible, he meant, not because of the treatment of the natives per se, but because the ostensibly civilized British degraded themselves when they assumed the position of racial superiors. Under such circumstances, he believed, all notions of Christian benevolence were forgotten, and with British men and women alike, all that remained in their minds was detestation, contempt, ferocity, vengeance, whether Chinamen or Indians be the object. Nevertheless, he found himself drawn partly into their world, and acknowledged with a measure of sarcasm that the awkward feeling of being surrounded by native servants soon wears off, and one moves among them with perfect indifference, treating them not as dogs, because in that case one would whistle to them and pat them, but as machines with which one can have no communion or sympathy. Elgin's misgivings about Britain's colonial project in India helped compound his already ambivalent feelings about his country's past conduct in China, which he had studied on the voyage over. "It is impossible to read the Blue Books," he wrote, "without feeling that we have often acted toward the Chinese in a manner which is very difficult to justify." Though, as with his musings on India, his line of thinking in this case didn't lead to any particular sympathy for the oppressed. "And yet their treachery and cruelty," he concluded about the Chinese, "come out so strongly at times as to make almost anything appear justifiable." Leaving India with little more than a borrowed ship and a troubled conscience, Elgin had to wait several months in Hong Kong before new reinforcements arrived to replace the troops he had left behind in Calcutta. By then, it was too late in the season to sail up the Bai He, which had frozen over with winter ice. Beijing would be landlocked until the spring. Anxious for some kind of productive action, he rallied with the French to bomb and then occupy the balmier southern city of Canton instead. It wasn't a perfect substitute for direct contact with the emperor in Beijing, but they hoped their display of firepower in the south would at least get the sovereign's attention. They didn't, however, realize the role they had begun to play in the Civil War. For when they invaded and took possession of Canton, they also, quite unintentionally, put an end to the gruesome program of anti-Taiping executions under its governor-general, who happened to be the same official who had ordered the capture of the Arrow. British troops hunted him down for alleged crimes against the British crown and captured him as he tried to escape out the back of a colleague's home. They tied him up and shipped him off to India, where he would die in British captivity. Now, after the spring thaw, here they finally were at the mouth of the Baihe, waiting patiently for an imperial commissioner to come and give them their new treaty. The weeks passed with a boredom numbing even to those who made their lives on ships. The vessels rocked sickeningly in the muddy swells, the bay so shallow that at 9 miles out they sat at anchor in just 25 feet of water. By day there were the fog and sometimes the distant thread of shore. By night, the black water glowed with a brilliant phosphorescence that served as the only reminder that there was supposed to be some kind of magic in this celestial kingdom, as those who had never been there liked to imagine it. Stores were running low. Some of the sailors sketched or read to pass the time. Others took pot shots at seagulls. The Marines practiced drills in preparation for a land invasion. Occasionally, a junk-rigged ship with ribbed sails ventured out from shore carrying a handful of Qing officials under a flag of truce. The diplomatic discussions were empty, but the visits at least broke the monotony of the day, and all could sit down to a meal together. The French ambassador, Baron Gros, couldn't quite read the imperial officials or their motives, and the typical exchange found the Europeans asking to be allowed upriver to negotiate their treaty peacefully, while the Manchus made excuses to put them off. At one point, an imperial official mentioned offhand that they weren't really all that concerned if the Allied fleet should decide to shell the forts, because the soldiers manning them were merely Chinese. It was a bluff, perhaps, yet perhaps not. But in any case, it was a clear reminder that this was an empire of two races, the ruling Manchus and the subject Chinese, which made the Europeans uncomfortable. As the weather cleared, the smaller boats made reconnaissance trips near the shore, close enough to see through a spyglass that the giant brass guns were being pushed on wheels to track them, and the matches were kept lit and ready to fire the fuses. A boom had been laid across the main channel to block ships from passing. The French interpreter was disappointed by the landscape. A country more parched, desolate, and miserable. It is impossible to imagine, he wrote. Nothing is to be seen but mud, slime, salt pans, and a few sandhills. Not a trace of vegetation meets the eye. Proper intelligence was hard to come by, and they had to rely on the cagey Russians, whose shared border with the Qing Empire meant closer relations. A teacher who had just returned from a Russian college in Beijing reported that the emperor was livid at the demands of the foreigners, and few of his ministers dared to speak to him about anything having to do with diplomatic affairs. As the empire crumbled around him, the rumors said that Xian Feng was spending most of his time on horseback, trotting idly about the wooded parts of the summer palace grounds with his concubines. A commissioner never materialized, and so, on May 20th, 1858, at 10:08 in the morning, the fleet attacked. A signal flag went up, and the HMS Cormorant, its crew lying flat and hugging the deck, built up to full speed and smashed, shuddering, through the boom blocking the river, opening the route for the rest of the fleet. A trio of gunboats, one British and two French, took up position to attack the two forts on the north bank, while three others attacked the south. Pulling up the rear, six of the light gunboats towed launches with a landing party totaling 1,800 British and French Marines. The initial response from the forts was more spirited than they expected, and it was hardly a textbook advance. One of the French ships got its screw caught in a fishing net and bobbed, helpless, for 15 minutes in a hail of shot that killed 11 of her crew. But the Taku gunners had set their aim high, not expecting an attack at low tide, and most of their salvos whistled harmlessly through the ship's rigging. Chinese cannons were lashed into place with ropes, so it was no simple matter to adjust their angle of elevation on the fly. It was the erroneous shots, falling short of their mark, that proved most deadly. One French ensign's head was ripped off by a cannonball. Another shot cut a midshipman on the Dragon, neatly in two, the halves of his body flipping overboard as his sword fell clattering to the deck. As the Allied gunships took up positions, they laid in with broadsides of canister and grapeshot. Congreve rockets, guided by long stabilizers, hissed in fiery arcs to explode against the walls. The forts had been designed to withstand small-caliber fire from coastal pirates and Chinese rebels, and the gunners inside were largely unprotected from the shells of the British and French cannons. The northern forts, though sturdily built, were arranged obliquely to the channel and open behind, leaving them completely exposed from the flank to the long-range guns of the Cormorant as it steamed upstream beyond them to get a good angle. As the dead piled up behind the fortifications, the landing party hit the muddy flat and slogged forward to the wall of the first fort, muskets in hand. The Qing commanders hadn't encountered this tactic before, so their gunners all but ignored the landing party, keeping the concentration of their fire on the ships. As the Marines and Blue Jackets stormed the defenses, shrieking and whooping and firing their muskets, the defenders turned and ran. There were few casualties in the landing party, save a handful of French troops caught near a powder magazine when it exploded. From a safe distance, the American observers watched through their glasses as bodies of Frenchmen were lofted through the air and fell back to earth at a distance from the fort. In the end, the invaders counted 500 Chinese troops dead, while the rest of the roughly 3,000 who defended the forts had apparently scattered. It was nothing less than the fleet's commanders expected. A New York Times correspondent who sailed on the American ship went so far as to brag that the Allies must always be victorious where they can bring their floating batteries to bear. Elgin was certainly not surprised, notwithstanding the Royal Navy's wisdom that a ship's a fool to fight a fort. He had never imagined that the native Chinese defenses would hold out for long against his battle-hardened Crimean War veterans. He was, however, somewhat sniffy toward the French, who, in his words, had blundered a good deal with their gunboats and then contrived to get blown up by setting fire to a powder magazine. The joint forces looted the forts, filling their ships with money, food, and especially the heavy brass cannons that were the real prize, worth hundreds of thousands of dollars apiece for the metal they contained. The inscriptions showed them to be new, cast during Xianfeng's reign. They also took note that despite the easy victory, the defenders' weapons weren't nearly as primitive as they had expected. Some of the guns were even British, salvaged from shipwrecks or purchased secretly in Shanghai, and the sandbag fortifications were professionally laid out. The victory was more one of training than of materiel. Nearby camps held glimpses of Qing military discipline, a soldier's body beheaded for running away from his station, and, more disconcerting to European eyes, the body of one fort's commander, throat slit by his own hand in defeat. Bidding farewell to the larger ships, which drew too much water to cross the bar, the ambassadors and their entourages crowded onto the boats with shallower draft and entered the channel. The peasants watching from shore seemed terrified, and at one of the first villages they passed, the men all prostrated themselves on the ground by the side of the river, shouting something that Elgin's interpreter translated awkwardly as, "Hail, great king! Oh, pray be pleased to disembark and reign over us." As Elgin's secretary saw it, the villagers were clearly under the impression that we were on our way to upset the dynasty. It was not an unreasonable assumption. These were the first foreign ships to sail up the Baihe in anyone's memory, a fact of which captains and crew alike were proudly aware. Not that there hadn't been British ambassadors here before. Lord Amherst had come in 1816, and Lord Macartney before him in 1793. But those missions had been forced by Xian Feng's imperial ancestors to fly the distinguishing flag of a tribute mission come to honor the Qing throne. So now, as Elgin's fleet advanced up the river under their own national colors, they imagined themselves avenging the humiliations of the past, and, more even than that, finally teaching a lesson to an empire whose officials thought of them as barbarians. Beneath the pride, however, Elgin mused darkly on the other kind of uncharted territory into which they were embarking. "Whose work are we engaged in?" he asked in a letter home. "When we burst thus with hideous violence and brutal energy into these darkest and most mysterious recesses of the traditions of the past." But as with his earlier broodings, he did not find the necessary element of romance in his heart that would defend China on its own grounds. And he concluded almost nihilistically, "At the same time, there is certainly not much to regret in the old civilization, which we are thus scattering to the winds." They anchored that first night about 20 miles upriver from the forts. Bonfires blazed on the shore, conjuring demons in the murky shadows and setting the spans of the ships aglow in flickering outline against the blackened sky. The slow navigation up the Baihe toward Tianjin continued the next morning. The river meandered so lazily that the distance by water was at least twice that on land. But this was the only way to get the big guns to a place where they could unnerve the emperor. The riverbed was shallow and thick with sediment, so even the light gunships ran aground constantly. One of the French vessels grounded 32 times, another 42. Yet slowly they made their way, and slowly the river unraveled its mysteries. At one turn, a human corpse edged into view, half buried in the mud of the riverbank. If it seemed abandoned by the world of men, not so for the two snarling bulldogs who fought over it, twisting to find an angle on each other's throat, forepaws pressed against the rotting carcass to stake their claim. The hours passed patiently, and the men on the ships saw neither imperial soldiers nor any kind of overt hostility from the crowds of peasants that traced their progression from shore, walking along beside them as the ships puffed their white smoke and pushed upstream against the current. These were not the howling masses of Chinese made famous by missionaries under attack, nor did they appear as the incensed citizens of a nation invaded. The men on board the ships could find nothing to indicate whether they cared one way or the other about the fate of their emperor. Indeed, for the mass of Chinese peasants, the existence of the emperor was a distant abstraction, a choice made by heaven in which they had no part. As the fleet climbed the river without incident, the initial fear of the crowds gave way to a wary curiosity, even an odd sense of cooperation at times. When a ship ran aground in the mud, its crew would throw a rope to the crowd, and the men on shore would pull them free. This happened repeatedly. Some were paid for their efforts in ship's biscuits, a great delicacy for them, the French attaché imagined, while others were paid in looped strings of copper cash looted from the Taku forts. There was more money in exceedingly small denominations than the crews knew what to do with. Sometimes they simply flung handfuls of it at the crowd on the shore to watch the scramble. Upstream, mud gave way to intense cultivation. New world corn, millet, lettuce, radishes. Piles of salt mined from the saline flats broke the monotony of the landscape, standing like cairns marking an uncertain path. A distant pagoda broke free from its shroud of mist. As the aggressors slid along into the reach of the walled city of Tianjin, the mud houses that flanked the river give way to denser wooden structures. Here was the junction of the Grand Canal, and mountains of rice and other grains lay along one bank. The tax revenues of the central government, what it had managed to collect from the territories that weren't cut off by the rebellion. Here the throngs of watchers became denser as well, crowding the rooftops to view the fleet, an oblique plain of upturned faces and bare heads that extended almost from the surface of the water to the eaves of the houses. As the boats in the river parted to give the fleet passage and the dynasty's soldiers failed to materialize, the European crews finally shattered the tense silence with a loud cheer. "We felt Tianjin was ours," recalled the captain of the Furious, "and that in it we held the throat of China." They anchored in Tianjin and gave up on the final overland leg to Beijing, 70 miles away. The summer heat topped 100 degrees in the sun, and European soldiers accustomed to cooler climates could barely move, let alone haul their weapons and equipment for miles through the brutal heat to the capital city. But their invasion this far was enough. The emperor capitulated and sent commissioners to negotiate a treaty that would keep them from moving beyond Tianjin. So they took up quarters for the month, Lord Elgin and Baron Grow claiming one of the grandest homes in the city as their headquarters, the British living in one half and the French in the other. The Americans and Russians rented a house across the river, though its owner offered to pay them money to stay away from it. Wisely, it would turn out, when imperial officials punished anyone who held willing commerce with the invaders. The imperial commissioners soon arrived and began the negotiations for new treaties, four of them, one for each of the powers that sent a representative. Not that it was in any way an equal exchange, with the gunships bristling with ordnance moored expectantly in the river. Britain's resulting treaty of peace, friendship, and commerce, titled without a whit of intended irony, was one to delight the foreign merchants. According to its terms, British ships would now have the right to sail up the Yangtze, China's main artery, reaching from Shanghai deep into central and western China. Beyond the five coastal treaty ports already open to foreign trade, 10 others would be open in the north, on Taiwan and inland along the Great Yangtze. To please the missionaries who held such sway with the Americans, there were stipulations that foreigners could travel wherever they wanted in the empire and that native Christians would be protected. This was not, of course, understood to apply to the Taiping. Also, Qing officials were not to be allowed to call the British barbarians anymore, not even in their private communications. The French, Russian, and American ministers all signed their own separate treaties in kind. But beyond any of those terms, the clause of the treaty that troubled the Xianfeng Emperor the most was the one that granted Britain the right to station an ambassador in Beijing, who would be allowed to come and go whenever he pleased. It had not been approved in advance, and as the dynasty depended above all on prestige to sustain its rule, it was potentially the most devastating. The emperor's stature had already been brought low by the ongoing war with the Taiping, but at least the influence of the rebels was in check, and the north of China remained nominally in imperial hands. Nominally, that is, because in the vacuum of power as the Qing concentrated its best forces against Nanjing, bandit rebellions under a group loosely known as the Nian had broke out in the north and ravaged the countryside through which the fleet had just come. On top of all this, to have foreign ships sailing up and down the main ceremonial waterway to the capital, carrying their ambassadors to and fro with no sign of tribute, no acknowledgement of the emperor's prestige, in full view of the river-dwelling public, meant that rumors would spread through the empire that the dynasty was not only incapable of keeping order within the country, but also unable to command the respect of foreigners anymore. It would sever what slim threads of legitimacy the emperor still enjoyed. As a small reassurance, the commissioner who agreed to the clause suggested to Xianfeng that the treaties were nothing more than slips of paper to make the barbarians leave Tianjin, and the emperor could easily cancel them if he wished. And so the foreign envoys were bid farewell to return to their home countries, with an appointment to return in 1 year with ratified copies of the treaties for exchange in Beijing. Xianfeng hoped very much that that would never happen. Despite having just established himself for posterity as the figurehead of British gunboat diplomacy in China, Lord Elgin regretted his invasion of Tianjin, and indeed was ashamed of the whole sequence of events that had led up to it. The affair of the smuggling ship, Arrow, that had sparked Britain's new China war was, in his words, a scandal to us. But he knew that his misgivings put him in a minority. The massive weight of British public opinion came down firmly on the side of war with China. That is to say, war with its imperial masters, the Qing, for rejecting trade and insulting the British crown. Against this popular sentiment, the majority liberals in Parliament had, in 1857, mounted a conscientious attempt to block Prime Minister Palmerston's call for war, with the young William Gladstone giving a fully two-hour-long speech, the finest delivered in the memory of a man in the House of Commons, according to one excited partisan, in which he charged that the whole might of England was about to be unleashed against the lives of a defenseless people in China. When the vote in the Commons went Gladstone's way, Lord Palmerston simply dissolved the government and held new elections, dubbed the Chinese elections by the British press, which returned Palmerston's pro-war faction to power in a popular landslide. Whatever Elgin's private misgivings might be, he knew exactly what his countrymen desired. And as he noted in his journal in November, a few months after the invasion of Tianjin, if the tone of the British papers was any indication, the public back home would have preferred that he had used far more force and plundered the wretched Chinese to a greater extent than is the case. The craving for war with China's imperial government was abundant, even in the United States, where news of the treaty arrived in record time, leading the first substantive news dispatch over the just-completed transatlantic cable. A joyful response greeted the news of trade concessions, but the joy was tempered by grumblings of frustration, not because the youthful, righteous United States had been tainted by association with the predatory gunships of Britain and France, but because it hadn't led the way. In an implicit attack on President James Buchanan's own policy of neutrality, a New York Times editorial declared that the French and English, in commencing a war which must sooner or later bring the Chinese government to terms, adopted the wiser and more politic course. The new treaty held unprecedented value, the editors maintained, and constituted the entire abandonment of that seclusive policy which has ruled in China from periods beyond the reach of history. It ensured that 1/3 of the population of the globe is opened to evangelical enterprise. Such grand results, they declared, proved beyond doubt the necessity of maintaining a large military and naval force within striking distance of the capital. In a separate editorial entitled, short-sightedly, End of the China War, they even went so far as to declare that this treaty at gunpoint had been necessary because force was the only argument which the Chinese could be made to recognize. American neutrality, far from being a point of moral pride, was for them instead a badge of weakness and passivity. For, in a matter of such great interest to us as our trade with China, we have allowed others to do the work and reap the honor, while we are content enough to pocket the profits. As a contrast to the model of aggressive diplomacy in China that so disturbed his conscience, Elgin was relieved to depart from Tianjin at the end of July and sail to China's smaller neighbor, Japan, under instructions to sign a similar trade agreement with the government there. The conditions could hardly have been more different. The ruling Tokugawa shogunate in Japan held every bit as much disdain for British trade and proselytizing as its counterpart government in China did. but it benefited from Japan's secondary status in East Asia, which proved an advantage when the vastness of Chinese markets ensured that the British guns aimed there first. Influential samurai in Japan had watched from the sidelines as Britain's ships broke China open in the Opium War of 1839 to 1842. So when the American Commodore Matthew Perry first arrived on Japan's shore with a fleet of steamships in 1853, they sidestepped China's fate by willingly signing a trade agreement with him. By the time Elgin arrived in 1858 to open Great Britain's relations with Japan, the Japanese not only had a precedent in their treaty relations with the United States, but also knew exactly what had happened so recently at the Taku forts when the Manchus had tried to block his advance. With more than sufficient warning, the Japanese government swallowed its pride and welcomed Elgin and his ships without resistance. It agreed to a set of treaties parallel to the Chinese ones, with no exercise of violence. In contrast to the mounting belligerence between Britain and the Qing dynasty, the Japanese fired a salute in Elgin's honor. The shogun's friendly diplomacy had its desired effect, and Elgin remembered the Japanese as the nicest people possible, none of the stiffness and bigotry of the Chinese. That same lack of belligerence helped soothe Elgin's guilt over his country's broader conduct in Asia. On leaving Japan, he wrote that it was the only place which I have left with any feeling of regret since I reached this abominable East. Abominable not so much in itself as because it is strewn all over with the records of our violence and fraud. The return to China, however, filled him with a sort of terror. By the late autumn of 1858, Elgin's mission in Asia was complete. But before returning to England, he took 3 weeks to make a voyage with a small fleet of 5 ships up the Yangtze River through the Taiping-held territories to the new treaty port of Hankou. Of all the ports opened by the treaty, Hankou was the one farthest up the river, and it was currently in imperial hands. On record, Elgin wanted to test whether Chinese officials on the river respected the status of the British flag under the new treaty. But it was also a chance to see the realm of the rebels. He had heard vague rumors about the Taiping while in Shanghai, but wanted to gauge them for himself firsthand. Though the Tianjin Treaty gave British ships the right to sail freely on the Yangtze, it was signed with only one of the 2 powers that controlled stretches of the river, and Elgin found the situation artificial. As we have seen fit to effect neutrality between the Emperor of China and the rebels, he wrote to the Foreign Secretary, we couldn't, of course, without absurdity, require him to give us rights and protection in places actually occupied by a power which we treat with the same respect as his own. In this case, the neutrality of Britain in China's internecine war was, he recognized, an affectation. For no course of action involving the one party in China could be undertaken without benefit or disadvantage to the other. From what little Elgin could see from the bridge of the Furious and a few short excursions inland, the impact of the civil war was more devastating than anyone in Shanghai had led him to believe. I never before saw such a scene of desolation, he reported of the city of Zhenjiang, which stood at the strategic junction where the Grand Canal, which ran north toward the capital, met the Yangtze. Imperial forces had recovered Zhenjiang from the Taiping less than a year earlier, and nothing was left after the fighting but heaps of ruins intersected by a few straggling streets. As another in his party described it, we might have imagined ourselves in Pompeii. We walked along deserted streets, between roofless houses and walls overgrown with rank, tangled weeds. Heaps of rubbish blocked up the thoroughfares, but they obstructed nobody. No more than a few hundred residents remained, scratching out a ghostly existence in a city that had held more than 300,000 before the war. The desolation of Zhenjiang was hardly isolated. As Elgin noted grimly in his account, In order to save repetition, I may here observe once for all that with certain differences of degree, this was the condition of every city which I visited on my voyage up and down the Yangtze. Elgin's first direct contact with the rebels came in the form of a cannonball that sailed over the deck of his ship as the fleet worked its way upriver past Nanjing. He hadn't expected any hostilities, planning somewhat obtusely to slip past the main Taiping shore batteries on his way up to Hangzhou, sending a gunship ahead with a white flag of truce, which, however, had no particular meaning to the rebels. The defenders took Elgin's ships for Imperial forces, which in fact clustered eagerly to Elgin's rear, hoping to use his fleet as a wedge to attack the rebel capital, and fired steadily on them as they steamed past, killing one British sailor and wounding two others. Elgin, oddly and perhaps undeservedly charmed, escaped injury, though one ball went right through his cabin and several others cut the rigging just above.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.